as early as possible. I'm reminded of a story this morning about a father and a son who were walking in a forest, and the daddy, being stronger, was taking longer strides, and the son was playing around and slowly beginning to follow the dad. So once in a while, the dad would look behind to make sure that the son was in steps. At one of the times, as the dad looked back, he froze in horror because the son was playing under a tree which had a serpent right on top. A snake was slowly reaching out to capture the son. The father, being very, very wise, told the son, "On your knees, kneel." The son did exactly that. And he said, "Crawl to Papa." And he did that. A couple of steps later, the daddy goes and picks the son and runs to safety. And when he gets to safety, he takes the son and makes him to look at that snake now that has come down to the ground, disappointed. The picture that I see there is a father who knows our needs even before we tell him. The picture that I see there is a son who is willing to obey and listen to the daddy and do what the daddy wants immediately. And the final picture that I see there is fruitfulness. In that particular context, it was salvation. How terrible it would have been for the father to see his son being a prey for a hungry, big, large snake. Generations ago, years ago, our Heavenly Father, even before we knew that we needed salvation, sent His own Son, who was willing to obey the Father no matter what. That's a perfect example of Jesus that we see, a God, a Son who obeys the Father no matter what. That is why on the cross of Calvary, He said, "It is finished." And when He said, "It is finished," it is finished for every one of us. My precious brothers and sisters, when we preach the Word of God, when we hear the Word of God, it is my prayer that we will have this attitude. We will understand what exactly God is telling us through Luke 11, and then we'll be able to move forward. We'll be looking into the book of Luke chapter 11 today, verses 1 to 13, and we'll have Miriam reading for us those scriptures, and then we'll move into what the Spirit has to tell us, to teach us, to impart to us, that we may leave this place with the fullness of God, that we'll be replete with joy of the Lord, and all the things that God wants us to have. Luke 11, 1 to 13, without losing any time.
Let's read from Luke 11. "And one day Jesus was praying in a certain place. When he finished, one of his disciples said to him, 'Lord, teach us how to pray, just as John taught his disciples.' He said to them, 'When you pray, say, Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation.' Suppose you have a friend, and you go to him at midnight and say, 'Friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread. A friend of mine on a journey has come to me. I have no food to offer him.' And suppose the one inside answers, 'Don't bother me. Door is already locked, and my children and I are in bed. I can't get up and give you anything.' I tell you, even though he will not get up and give you the bread because of friendship, yet because of your shameless audacity, he will surely get up and give you as much as you need. So I say to you, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. The one who seeks finds. And to the one who knocks, the door will be opened. Which of you fathers, if your son asks for a fish, will give him a snake instead?"
13.
"Or if he asks for an egg, he will give a scorpion. If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him?"
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you. You're good. Let's go through those scriptures. Very important for us to observe the scriptures and read it. There are different kinds of denominations in the world. Pentecostals are one group of people who give a lot of importance to the Spirit. And there is a proverb made by men
Pentecostals are more spirit than word. They don't know the scriptures. We must make it a point that we know the scriptures thoroughly. That is why we take so much of pain to get people to read the scriptures, that we may hear the written scriptures also. How many of you believe that the written scriptures are as important as the spoken word? Some people give a lot of importance to the spoken word. Some people give a lot of importance to the written scriptures. This morning's children of God, I want you to know, both are coherent. Both have the same nature. As we move into the charismatic world, we will hear a lot of people saying, I heard God saying something. I heard a voice when I was praying. I am for all that. But one of the greatest charismatics who lived, John Wesley, he said, do not think that every word and every sentence and every vision and every dream that you have is from the Holy Spirit. And this morning, it is my right to tell you, whatever experiences you have must be coherent with the scriptures. It must be in tune. It must have the same flavor and same taste as the written scriptures. And before I go further, I want to tell you, the word of God, which is written down, has at least two things in it. It has the word of God. It has also the letter in which it is written. More of it later as we look into Luke 11 today. One, it came to pass that as he was praying, Jesus was praying in a certain place, when he stopped, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray. Chances are it was Peter. One of his disciples asked a question and everybody is edified. People of God, when you pray, one of you may be praying for something which other people may not be praying for. Morning, I want you to know, continue to pray. When you may be praying for something that other people may not be praying, you may be lifting up a voice for a thousand people group all over the world. Here is one disciple asking Jesus, and is the rest of the people are being benefited. Lord, teach us to pray as John also taught his disciples. Who do you think that disciple would be? It could be Peter, because he was formerly a disciple of John the Baptist. It could be Peter, Andrew, James, or John, one of them, because they were under the umbrella of John the Baptist. Now they are under the umbrella of Jesus, the rabbi. Always remember, you should be under one umbrella of teaching. You should be under one umbrella of thought. You should be under one discipline. If you are not under one, you can easily get swayed. People today have this idea. I get into the YouTube on 10 o'clock, I watch this, 11 o'clock, I watch this, 12 o'clock I watch this. I want you to know, unless and until you're willing to stay and stick to one school of thinking, to one understanding, it will be very difficult for you to graduate in the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is not looking for people who have different schools of thinking. The kingdom of God is looking for disciples who will be discipled into one school of thinking at one point of your life with the Lord. I hope I've come in very clearly. That is why the local pastor has a problem. He has to hold the people to understand what God is telling them. And then he also has to operate in freedom. Unfortunately, a lot of people who take the law into their own hands, they choose to please every pastor in town. They choose to please every person in town. They think that their prayers will be answered because of their own righteousness. This morning, I encourage you, people of God, may we be people who go by one school of thinking for at least a period of time till the Holy Spirit begins to graduate us. John, Andrew, Peter, James are all people who were under the school of thinking and school of teaching till Jesus Christ, the fullness of God, came. And when Jesus came, John the Baptist was so humble to allow these people to go and be with Jesus. Stick on till you find the Lord Jesus Christ himself leading you to greener pastures, which is the life with Jesus himself. Till such time, God has called us to stick on to one school of thinking. Here is a school of thinking about prayer. It came to pass that he was praying in a certain place. Very important point. Jesus was praying in a certain place. When he stopped praying, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray, as John also taught his disciples. And Jesus answers to the whole church or to the whole group of disciples. He said to them, When you pray, say. നിങ്ങൾ പ്രാർത്ഥിക്കുമ്പോൾ ഈ വണ്ണം പറവീൻ. വെൻ യു പ്രേ, സേ ദാറ്റ് മീൻസ് പ്രേയർ ഈസ് മോർ ദാൻ വാട്ട് യു സേ ഓർ സ്പീക്ക് ടു യുവർ ഹെവൻലി ഫാദർ. പ്രേയർ ഈസ് നോട്ട് ജസ്റ്റ് എ ലിസ്റ്റ് ഓഫ് വേർഡ്സ് ഓർ സെന്റൻസസ് ഓർ സ്റ്റേറ്റ്മെന്റ്സ്. Prayer is more than your words and my words. Prayer is attitude. Prayer is the right nature. Prayer is the right spirit. There are so many things in prayer. Prayer cannot be narrowed down to saying something. Elsewhere, the Bible tells us the Gentiles pray a lot of things, expecting God to answer their prayer. But when you pray, pray like this. In other words, what you say is not as important as the rest of the things in prayer. That is why the Bible tells us the prayer of a righteous man availeth much. In other words, a righteous person, when he prays, he can expect greater things, more things than when an ordinary person prays. That is why Jesus said, when you pray, say, and these are the things that you should say. Our Father who art in heaven, number one, hallowed be thy name. Number two, your kingdom come. Number three, your will be done as in heaven, so in earth. Number four, give us day by day our daily bread. Number five, forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone that is indebted to us. Number six, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Let us go through that. Take a little time in the Holy Spirit. Pray that the Holy Spirit will give our ears hearing and our mind understanding, that we may be under the mind of Christ who makes all things to possible for us. He said, when you pray, number one, our Father who art in heaven. You have a heavenly Father who is different, who is not your Father on earth, but you have a heavenly Father who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. I have taught you many times. I myself have followed a practice where I can go and pray to God at any time. That is our right as sons of God. We have been translated into the kingdom of his dear son. At the same time, Holy Ghost balance reminds us we don't take the name of God in vain. Oh yeah, I'm his son. That is one side of the truth. But the other side is my heavenly Father needs to be respected. You know, these days, in the last 25, 30 years, children have become very friendly with their fathers. It's a good thing, because another generation came before that, where the fathers always used to keep aloof. The fathers, in fact, never even spoke to the girls in the house. There was a social scenario in Asia at that time because women were always looked down upon. A generation came in retaliation to the previous generation. Now, parents are very close to the children, which is a good thing. But I want to tell you, when you and I take advantage of the freedom we have with our Heavenly Father, something goes wrong in our relationship with our Heavenly Father. He stands to be honored, hallowed, no matter what your position is in Christ Jesus. Jesus never disrespected the Father. Jesus always obeyed the Father and always honored the Father, always gave him the right place. That is our stand. Hallowed be thy name. And now you see the next thing. Your kingdom come. May your kingdom come. I want to make a small correction in balance there also. Holy Spirit balance. Say with me if you like. Holy Spirit balance, or the balance brought in by the Holy Spirit. Some time ago, a couple of weeks ago, a good friend of mine, I love him a lot, very respected among Christian circles in India, he sent me a message and said, Pastor, do you know that we are already in the kingdom of God's dear son? In other words, these prayers were meant only for the disciples of Jesus before the Holy Spirit came. I said, that's fine. That's wonderful. I agree. The Bible tells us in the book of Ephesians that we have been translated into the kingdom of God. Therefore, the implication could be that we need not pray this prayer. This morning, according to the calling of God in my life, it is my right to set things right for you first of all, and whoever may listen. When Jesus asks us to pray that the kingdom of God will come, he expects us to continuously pray even when you are in the kingdom of his dear son. The book of Ephesians tells us you have been translated into the kingdom of his dear son. I am in the kingdom of his dear son Jesus Christ. I have the kingdom of God in me. And when we get together, it is the kingdom of God that we value. But you must remember, there is also a particular understanding given to us by Apostle Paul, who said that the Son will hand over the kingdom at the completion of all things. In other words, we are not to stop praying that the kingdom of God may come, even when we are translated into the kingdom of his dear Son. And those of you who are very particular about the verbatim, word to word, here it is says in Ephesians, you have been translated into the kingdom of his own Son. And the Son is going to transfer you and the kingdom back to the Father at a time. And those of us who are in the kingdom will be so happy that we chose to be in the kingdom of God's Father, which has right now been handed over to the Son. That is why Jesus said, all authority has been given to me. But a time is coming. He's going to hand back that authority back to the Father. I hope a complete picture has come. Let not part of a scripture, let not somebody's understanding keep away the full counsel of God. If you would love to say that word, full counsel of God, please say it out to the Lord in prayer. Lord, when I pray, when I study the scriptures, let me not belong to a group of people who may take one word, one verse, one thing out of context and start their own kingdom, because I have been called into the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ, and I continuously press forward with kingdom principles, so that at the time when Jesus comes, I will continuously be in the kingdom. And when Jesus hands over the kingdom back to the Father, I will also be there. Let's move on. Praise God. Jesus continues to teach his disciples, your will be done as in heaven, so on earth. Your will be done as in heaven. In heaven, there is only one voice. That's the voice of Almighty God. That's the voice of God the Father. That's the voice of Jesus Christ. That's the voice of the Holy Spirit. There's only one voice. On earth also, there should only be one voice. If you apply it in the families, there should only be one voice. Our children should be hearing only one voice. They should not be hearing the daddy and then the mummy saying something else. They should not be listening to the mummy and the daddy saying something else. They should be listening to one voice. A lot of personality issues rises up in a generation because they grow up in families which are, excuse me for saying, dysfunctional. Dysfunctionality comes when there are two voices, and it is the Lord's desire to heal. The husband says something, even if the husband is a moron, it is good for a wife to keep quiet and pray that her voice will be heard, and a time will come that she will be able to understand and he will be able to understand that together there will be one voice in the kingdom of God. And somebody said an amen to that. In the church, there should be one voice. If you think that the pastor is not right, it is not right to oppose the man of God, but rather go on to your knees and say, Lord, we think that a pastor may be taking a wrong step. Lord, we think our pastor may not be going in the right way. And the right decision is to be on your knees. I love this theology called neology. How many of you agree with me? That is what we are going to look into. Our voices of differences are to be brought into our Heavenly Father, not between one another. That is the kind of voice, one voice in heaven. Let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. You and I have the kingdom of God. We and I have God's kingdom in us. When we are together, we have God's kingdom. We have one voice. Sunday after Sunday, we preach the same word which God has given to us, and we receive it, and we don't agree with it. We don't form a separate parallel committee or a parallel prayer group to destroy the word of God. It will not stand. Rather, if we have a difference of opinion, we are on our knees and say, Lord, I think that message didn't come from you. I think that probably came from the flesh. Lord, grant our man of God, grant our pastor, grant our teachers that they will always be able to speak the word of God with boldness and speak the word of God exactly as Jesus would have wanted to. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. What a beautiful application God has given to us. Verse 3, give us day by day our daily bread. The King James Version was translated not only word to word or letter to letter. The King James Version was translated from spirit to spirit. There is a story about the King James Version, that this version or this translation was written so that we may read it out. And if you have the King James Version, I know there is the thou and the thy and words which we do not use now, but at least for the sake of your reading out in the presence of God, it will be a good thing for you to speak it out, to read it out. And when you read it out, people of God, you see certain things which you don't find in other translations. Day by day, give us our food daily. What does it mean, day by day? Every one day after the other day? No. He is telling us to pray every day for our daily bread. He said unto them, yes, verse 3, give us day by day. Quick question, why don't we ask God, Lord, give me provision for 30 days. Lord, give me a salary check for 30 days. That is the practice in the world. But the answer would be, the translation in Greek which I see, which I commit to the Holy Spirit as I speak this to you, every day according to his need. Give me today according to what I need today. Because you know, people of God, every day is different. That is the meaning that I get from the Greek translation. Today is not tomorrow. Tomorrow is not yesterday. But we have the hope. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And he knows what we need. More than the Son, the Father knows what our needs are. You do not know what tomorrow is going to bring your way. In February, we were all meeting there. None of us ever thought that we'll be meeting together like this. Though this is beautiful, this is far better than being there. But our Heavenly Father already knew. Give us, Lord, give me today the ability to preach in the wind. Lord, give me the ability to preach when it was raining. Lord, give me the ability to preach when it is such a blaring sunshine. Every day has its challenge. Elsewhere, Jesus said, sufficient is the evil of that particular day. Pray for that particular day. That is why every person, the tradition of genuine Christians is to wake up in the morning and pray. This morning they came a little late, but I want to welcome my precious family from New York. And I remember them right now because this precious family is so devoted to prayer. Will you lift your hands for them and bless them? I'm so blessed and honored that they could be with us. They have so many testimonies which over a period of time God will tell us. To wake up in the morning, to pray, to set the day in prayer is exactly what we should do as disciples. Whatever happens, if you were to wake up at 3:45 every day, pray, spend time with your Heavenly Father, things will go well with you. A man called Stanley Jones. Stanley Jones was a preacher who came to India from England, if I remember correctly. Stanley Jones is reported to have said, if you meet with Jesus the first thing in the morning, you will not have to meet with the devil the rest of the day. And I think there is something in what he said. Of course, I know we all have different timing, shifts, etc., etc. But I tell you, if you can set apart the first and the best and the fresh part of your life, supposing you have a night duty and you are going to sleep at 7 o'clock in the morning, unfortunately, that is your calling of life. But as soon as you wake up from that 7 o'clock sleep up to 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock, the first thing that you can set apart is to spend time with God. Somebody received this in Jesus' name. Day by day. The Bible says, day by day, he carries my burden. That means every day has an evil and a burden by itself. But blessed are we when we pray day by day. Give us day by day. And then he says, give us day by day our daily bread. As Pastor George was saying, this is the living manna, not only on a Sunday. Every day when we get to our Heavenly Father, day after day, knowing that we are in the new covenant, there is a new word he would like to give you. Church, a new word every day he is willing to give to you. Do you know it is with that word we manage the affairs of this world? Why do I say that? Because the book of Hebrews chapter 1:3 tells me about Jesus Christ our Lord. He holds all things by the word of his power. So if you were to get up in the morning or any time you choose the best time of your day and receive a word, your daily manna. Though the Bible here talks about your daily bread, which definitely is your putta and kadala and all those stuff. Wonderful. But a greater thing I want to tell you is the word of God, which God wants to give you. And blessed are we when we receive that daily bread. Verse 4, please forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone that is indebted to us. Oh, I have something to tell you there. The Bible tells you in the book of Psalm 66, if you're not willing to forgive, if you hold on to somebody else's trespasses, God is not going to listen to your prayer. That is scary. That is very scary. If you're not willing to let go, If you're not willing to forgive, the Bible tells us here very careful, clearly, forgive us our sins as we also forgive everyone that is indebted to us. Probably this is the third time I'm saying to this wonderful group of people, it is reported that Martin Luther King prayed for the man who shot him. I was not there. I was not even born. But reportedly it is said he prayed for the man who shot him. What an excellent example. What an excellent example. Probably Dr. King did not have time to pray after he was shot, but he was willing to forgive and pray for the man. People of God, what an excellent example. We are called to forgive any person who may have ever hurt us. And it starts in the family. It starts in the family. Because a husband and a wife live together, many times they do not realize the words, the little words that hurt one another, the disappointments that come from one another, the children who are living in the same house, the expectations they have, all these things culminate into prayerlessness. This morning it is my desire that every family that listens to me will rise in prayer, will increase in prayer, will have the confidence that God is listening to our prayer. And we as parents, it is our duty to maintain relationships from the heart, and it starts by clean forgiveness. Praise God. Oh, people say, no, I have nothing against anybody. Hold on. Don't just stop it with that word. You don't have anything against anybody. Good, you're a good person. Somebody taught you that. Oh, I don't have anything against anybody. That's what you think. But shall I tell you, every time you are provoked to mention somebody or somebody's act by which you are hurt, that shows your inner heart has still not been healed. You may have forgiven that person. God would have accepted that forgiveness. It's okay, I've forgiven. But that hurt that has been brought in the heart continues. Once in a while, that begins to come out. You know, such and such a day, you said like this. You did like that to me. You pushed me down. You insulted me. Hold on, you need a healing. You need to forgive. You need to forgive. The more healing you require, the more you need to forgive. Think of the cross. Think of Jesus on the cross. I always think, Lord, how could you be on the cross so insulted, so publicly mocked? How could you pray to the Heavenly Father, Father, forgive them, they do not know what they are doing? It was a challenge Jesus overcame. There will be challenges like that if you want to be a disciple of Jesus. But the good news, precious saints of God, is that every prayer of ours will be heard and God will answer according to His wisdom. Will somebody say an amen to that? Every pain, every rejection, every insult that you and I may go through because we choose to be disciples of Jesus has a great fruit that your prayers will be answered. You will be encouraged to pray. Amazing. And he said unto them, now verse 5 onwards, we are going into part 2 of our message. If the first 4 verses were talking about the right thing to say, the next couple of verses is about the right posture in prayer. When I say posture, what I mean is the right attitude in prayer. What is the right attitude in prayer? Verse 5, he said to them, which of you shall have a friend and shall go to him at midnight, say to him, friend, lend me 3 loaves. For a friend of mine in his journey has come to me and I have nothing to set before him. And he from within shall answer and say, trouble me not. The door is now shut and my children are with me in bed. I cannot rise and give thee. There are at least 3 objections. Good friend, best friend, good friend, very close. So this person has the right to go and knock at the door so that the door can be opened. He's so bold about his friend's ability and availability to give him what he asks in a time of emergency. But this good friend is offering 3 objections. Number 1, do not trouble me. 2, the door is now shut. What a flimsy excuse, isn't it? 3, my children are with me in bed. Another flimsy excuse. I cannot rise and give you. 3 flimsy excuses. If he's a real friend, you may say, if he's a real good friend, he will forsake all these things. He will put all these things away and go and give his friend. But what? Jesus, this is what he teaches us from this part. I say to you, verse 8, though he will not rise and give him because he's his friend, yet because of his importunity, this morning we heard Miriam reading, because of his shameless asking, because of his shameless asking, he will rise and give him as many as he needs. What's the message there for us? The right attitude in prayer is perseverance. The right attitude in prayer is consistency. The right attitude in prayer is not taking advantage of the fact that you are with your Heavenly Father, that you have been translated into the kingdom of His dear Son. These are all privileges that God has given to us. This morning, church, I would like you to wake up and get into the act of consistently being at your Father's door, knocking, 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 till such time the door is open. Somebody received it in Jesus' name. The posture in prayer is not taking advantage. The posture in prayer is understanding that you have a Heavenly Father. The posture in prayer is knowing that He will answer your prayer. But there is something that God wants you to do. That is to be consistent in your request. If you ask some people, what did you pray for yesterday? They will forget. I used to be there. I was praying so fervently for something. Sunday I was praying for something. I didn't see an answer. But I forgot all about on Monday. Till you get God's word on the matter that you are praying for. Till you hear your heavenly Abba praying and answering you with His word. Either directly through the scriptures or even through circumstances. My brothers and sisters, we are encouraged to knock, knock, knock and keep on asking. Not because He's your heavenly Father, but because of a show of character He is going to give it to you. That's the message that we get here. He will give it to you, yes, because He's your Heavenly Father. He will give it to you because you are His sons. He will give it to you because you say in the name of Jesus. But I tell you, these are all privileges. But we are called to have and show a character of consistency and perseverance when you pray. And I believe these words which I speak to you are perfectly in tune with Luke chapter 17, where Jesus again tells us about a widow. She keeps going back to the judge. And she gets what she wants. But hold on, it's not over. Jesus says, want your heavenly Father, give to His saints who call Him in day and night, though He bear long with them. What is the meaning of that? One of the understanding I have is, God puts up with all the negativity, all our unbelief, till we come to a place where He will be able to give us what He has promised to us. The message is posture in prayer is the right attitude. And this morning I want to encourage you, the right attitude can be given by the Holy Spirit. The right attitude, the character of Jesus is being made available to us by the Holy Spirit when you are born again. When you are born again genuinely into the kingdom of God, you are also blessed with the kingdom of God inside your heart. But I must tell you, with the revelation I have, and if there is a better revelation, I'm open to it from the Holy Spirit. But I am of the understanding, you must work out what has been worked inside you. You have kingdom principles. You have the seed of prayer. If I may use my language, you have the anointment of prayer. You have the grace of prayer. But we know those who consistently pray become better prayer warriors. We know those who consistently preach become better. Practice definitely makes better. Though it is a secular thing, I tell you, apply the principles of the kingdom which Almighty God has already placed in your heart, and you will begin to see great, great fruit. I've been praying for all our young people these days that you'll all be great prayer warriors. I've been praying for all these young people. Their time will come. If the coming of the Lord tarries, we all have to go and be there with Him. But our children must become better prayer warriors, great intercessors. Shall I tell you something which I know in the spirit? This country is standing not because of its elegance, not because of its greatness. It is standing only because there are some people whose prayers and tears are still valued by Almighty God. And it is my prayer that we will be able to have a generation like that, a remnant. Had it not been for the remnant, the Bible says Judah would have been destroyed a long time. And it is our job to be part of the remnant. It is our job to pray and ask our Heavenly Father that the generation to come will also have the flames of fire, the flames of prayer in our heart. Can I say, hear an amen from you? Prayer is so beautiful. The more you come to it, you will begin to realize how much God wants to give to his children. But there is a condition. Let's go to verse 9. And I say to you, this is a promise, part 3. And I say to you, ask, it shall be given to you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened to you. Verse 10 goes with it. Everyone that asks receives, and he that seeks finds, and to him that knocks it shall be opened. I call it a New Testament promise. What is the nature of a promise, people of God? It is yes and amen. Now the Bible tells us that God is not a liar. God is not a man that he should tell a lie, implying to me that everything that God promises is yes and amen. He said, ask and it shall be given to you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and the door shall be open unto you. And we are encouraged for everyone. Not only people of in the tribe of Judah. Not only the children of Israel in the old covenant. Everyone. Not only sons of the kingdom, which you and I are. Everyone who asks receives. That is a universal principle of God. Everyone who asks receives. He that seeks finds. And to him that knocks, it shall be opened. Our duty is to knock and to seek and to find. If you put the first three words, A-S-K, it's easy to remember. Remember the song that I sang this morning? Seek ye first. Ask and it shall be given to you. Knock and the door shall be opened to you. You need to keep on knocking. Doors of opportunity. Keep on praying. Keep on asking. Keep on asking with assurance. This is what I want. And I want to see that happening. That is what Jesus is telling us to do. Even this morning. Ask for a place of worship. Somebody receive it in Jesus' name. Seek. Look. I know our brother is looking. He's every day he's looking for a new hall or a new place for us. Seek and we will find it. Knock and the door will be open. Corporately. Under the church. Individually. My brothers and sisters, here is a promise for any person, whatever level of spirituality you may be. You may be in, you may just have come to the kingdom of God. You may be in the church today because you want to find out what's happening in the revival church. You may be an anointed servant of the Lord. This principle is yes and amen for every one of us. Can we say that together? For everyone that asks receives, and he that seeks finds, and to him that knocks it shall be open. Now we go to verse 11, another level. I love this. If a son shall ask bread of any of you, that is the daddy, will you give him a stone? And if you ask a fish, will he for a fish give him a serpent? Or if he shall ask an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? Now verse 13, Jesus is calling me an evil daddy in this. Amen. If you then being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them that ask him? What is the comparison? I would rather ask God for the Holy Spirit instead of a lot of things. Can we take a step of faith in listening today? Can we ask the Lord to energize our understanding today? I have been praying for an anointment for a larger church. I have been praying for an anointment to shepherd and to preach to larger amount of people, more number of people. Do I hear an amen of understanding today? If you are praying for more finances, I am of the opinion, based on my understanding of the scripture, more than the things that you ask, the Holy Spirit is more important. If you are looking for your family to get right on track, I would rather pray that the Holy Spirit will take over my family. If I am praying for my church to be of any value in the kingdom of God, if I pray that my ministry is of some value for somebody, I should be praying for an anointment that comes from the Holy Spirit, which has a greater standing before God than all the things which I spoke of. May I break a conventional understanding, people of God? Many people say today, you know, if I had a little bit of money, my life would have been good, Pastor. That is true. You know, if 90% of problem in the world today can be overcome temporarily if you had a little more money. If you had a little more money, you wouldn't go for a third shift. If you had a little bit more money, if you were able to pay your mortgages,
If you could meet your bills every month, you would rather sit at home and pray, won't you? What is more important? If you had a little more money, definitely, I'm telling you, I'm standing in the pulpit. If you had a little more money, instead of your $2,000 check, if you had a $7,000 check, wow, 90% of prayer requests will come down. But the Bible tells us not to pray for money. Nothing wrong in asking for money. Don't get me wrong. But the Bible tells us to pray for things. Whatsoever things you ask, things are more important than money. You know, people like us who are in full time, we are taught by the Lord not to ask for money. When we started our ministry, we said, Lord, give me so much of money, then I'll be able to take care of a thing. Brother, why don't you ask God for the thing that you need? Lord, I need a sofa in my house. When we got our new house, we did not have everything bought in money. We had brothers and sisters who bought in things into our house. The sofa that many of you have come to my house, that sofa that is right in front, costs a lot of money. Somebody gifted it to us. We prayed, Lord, we need something there. I have a brother in a place called Koilon. He started a church many, many years ago, long time since I met with him. He used to tell me, Pastor, I got into a house. God gave me a house freely to live there. Everything in that house was brought in prayer. We needed a chair. We needed a sofa. We needed a stove. We needed a couple of chairs. Everything was brought in through prayer. Not money. Somebody receive it in Jesus' name. Don't think that money, if I had $2,000, I could buy this. Hold on. God wants to give you things. Church, let us come out of this bondage of thinking that everything can come from money. No. Everything can come through prayer. When you ask Him specifically, I want this. I have experience. My wife has experience. We have experience in asking God for things. But I'm going to tell you to another place. Greater is the Holy Spirit than all these things. The Holy Spirit is greater than all the things. If you have the Holy Spirit, in other words, Jesus is telling His disciples, guys, you can pray for money, you can pray for things, but a greater thing I'll show you, a better thing I'll show you. I will show you the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit is better than all these things. I live by the Holy Spirit. I live in the Holy Spirit. I pray in the Holy Spirit. I look at people through the Holy Spirit. And I tell you, one of the greatest things that you can have is the Holy Spirit. Jesus had the Holy Spirit, I'm sure you'll agree. That is why I want to tell you, church, today, never hold another man's mistake in your heart. A person may have made a mistake. A person may have asked God forgiveness. You don't know. But it is not your job or my job to continuously remind a person of that person's past failure. Do I hear an amen? If you have the Holy Spirit, you will not keep on reminding that person. Pastor George, you didn't do something correctly 3 years ago. If I continuously tell him that, I am not siding with the Holy Spirit. If I consistently remind him of his failures, I am not a part of the kingdom of God. I don't have the kingdom culture. But if I tell him, Pastor, whatever mistake you made, it is between you and God. My brother, I'll always love you. Somebody receive it. That's the way I live. Sorry, hon, I'm giving you trouble. That's the way I go. How am I able to forgive others? Because I have the Holy Spirit. How am I able to love one another? Because I have the Holy Spirit. Church, may I ask you a question? How do you expect to be in heaven if we don't have the culture of forgiving and releasing people? How do you think that heaven is going to be an okay culture? Pastor Anil, does she need some water? Grace, are you okay, hon? The Holy Spirit, how do you think we can get to be in the culture of heaven where Jesus Christ and a lot of forgiven people are in heaven, clapping hands to the Lord, putting on the robe of righteousness? Can you imagine us going there and saying, Lord, how did that person get into the kingdom? Lord, how dare he get into the kingdom, Lord? Lord, do you know who I am? I never sinned, Lord. I never told a lie, Lord. Oh, I was perfect, Lord. That is why I am in the kingdom of God. God says, hold on, son. The answer for you is given in the Bible. There was a very righteous man who thought he was very righteous. He said, God, I give tithe every day. Lord, I pray 7 times a day. There was another man who came into the kingdom and said, Lord, all I have in heaven and earth is you. I am a poor sinner. You are my righteousness. Church, wake up. If you have the Holy Spirit, the culture of the kingdom will be in your heart. And we will be able to pray, having no hurt in our hearts, no offenses in our heart, simple principles from the kingdom of God. I want to encourage all of us this morning, even as we continue to hold on to the season of prayer that God has given to us, may it be our portion to come to God. So those of you who are in the church right from the beginning, how beautiful it is for us to evaluate relationships between each other. Think of it. The other day, the Bible, I remembered a verse. I will make you to sing as in the beginning. The book of Hosea, there is a promise. I will make you to sing as in the beginning. And from there, I'll give you the vineyards, the valley of Achor, the valley of Achor. From there, I'll make you to sing again. How many of you want to sing again? The glorious song, the day you were born again. How many of you remember the day you were baptized? You decided to be baptized. You said, I take a step of faith today because I love Jesus. And then you went to a man of God. Remember the joy of the Lord. How many of you remember the day when you were born again? I still remember it. I was so full of joy. My God, my God. I remember the man of God. I remember those wonderful people who led me into the waters of baptism. I thank God for their lives, though I am not in touch with many of them. How many of you like to sing again unto the Lord? Can we get back there with a clean conscience? Husbands and wives, how about renewing those who are your relationship, evaluating your relationship one more time? What if that is blocking all the good spiritual blessings that God wants to bring your way? Ministers in the Lord, when you started your ministry, you were so simple and humble and innocent, and none of the things that you see there was there, but you started very, very little. At that time, you had more time to pray, more time to spend in the presence of God. But now you're so busy that you forget to sing. Do I hear an amen? But when we get back into the presence of God, He renews us. The Holy Spirit culture is always to renew our minds. The book of Romans tells us, renew your mind. But trusting in the Lord, I want to tell you, it's difficult for you to renew your own minds unless the Holy Spirit helps you. We need to get off our minds some of the things that nags us. Things of the past. Failures. Oh, I could have done like that. Oh, I took a long step of faith. Hold on. The Holy Spirit, through the Word of God and through the ministry, is able to purge your conscience to serve the living God. Give me a quick question before I conclude. How many of you like to get back to the age you are 30? I'm speaking to those who are above the age of 30. With the Holy Spirit, it is possible. With the Holy Spirit, you can get back your health. With the Holy Spirit, you can get back all that you have lost. The Holy Spirit is still active. My apologies to cessationists and people who teach the wrong things in Bible college. With all love to you, my brother, sister, the Holy Spirit is still the same. The same Holy Spirit that was there during the time of the apostles, He is still here. And this morning, when we pray for the Holy Spirit, it is 10:55. We have 5 more minutes in our prescribed time. With your permission, may I take time till 11:05. We are going to seek the Lord's face for the pouring out of the Holy Spirit. We are praying for a mighty revival to come. How many of you are agreed with me that this nation needs a revival? I know many of you are praying for the coming election, and I have no business in politicking in the pulpit. My vision is, don't get involved in politics, but I pray for the country. And I pray the righteousness of God will prevail. And I pray that God's candidate will come. But I tell you something. Even after November 3rd and November 4th, how many of you think this nation needs prayer? I do. Because somebody is not going to be happy with the outcome. Sadly, no offense to other countries, if you have observed the nation and the history of this nation, third world countries have brought in their culture into the country, even into politics. Those who know the history of this country, you know, once a man is made a president, everybody rallies with him. A united nation, United States of America, united. But in the last 12 years, a certain pattern has developed, a spiritual pattern which must be put to rest. If the person I voted for doesn't come up, then I'm going to oppose him and push him down. That is from the pits of hell. And this morning I stand under the authority of God and I renounce it in Jesus' name. That is not kingdom culture. United States of America had kingdom culture, even unknown to people who were in politics. But now a new rise spiritually is being seen. People of God, I want to tell you, if you don't pray against that, have no doubt, your children and generations to come may not be able to sing and pray and preach, even in this blessed country. Somebody received it in Jesus. We need the Holy Spirit. More than the government. In America, we don't look up at the government, we look at God. And let me add something there. In America, we pray for another revival to come. When the Holy Spirit is poured upon the 50 nations, when the people come under the authority of the Holy Spirit, when God begins to birth in the hearts of men, the need to pray and be in His presence, I tell you, one more time, God will make this nation to be the way God wants it to be. Can we start asking God for that revival today? My message is concluded today. I pray the Holy Spirit will continuously and consistently speak.